Quantum supremacy is that moment when a quantum computer beats the best supercomputers at solving some kind of problem. And it's a very exciting time right now in quantum computing because as of recording this video, we're on the brink of having quantum supremacy. Maybe it's already happened. So I'm going to explain what quantum supremacy is and why it's so exciting. So to explain quantum supremacy, it's worth me explaining how quantum computers work. As physicists, we call normal computers classical computers. And classical computers work with binary, there's loads of bits that can either be in a state of 0 and 1. In a quantum computer, you have quantum bits, qubits, which can be in the state 0 or 1, or they can be in a special intermediate state, and that's called a superposition. It's a special phenomenon in quantum physics that quantum computers take advantage of. Now, when you measure a qubit, the result you get is based on a probability. So if you set this superposition state to be in the middle, you've got a 50% chance of getting a 0 and a 50% chance of getting a 1. But you can tune that state, so you can make it so that you're more likely to get a 0 than a 1 or the other way around. So that's the first phenomenon of quantum physics quantum computers take advantage of. The second one is called entanglement, and this is where you bring together several qubits and you join them together, and now that whole thing has to be treated as one object. So if you take two qubits and you join them together, now this object can be in the mixed state of four states, so 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. Each time you add a new qubit, you double the number of states that this thing can be in, and that goes up exponentially. So if you want to search through a whole load of different states, a classical computer has to search through them one by one. But in a quantum computer, you've got these special quantum algorithms where you can enhance the probability of the state that you want and diminish the probability of it giving you back the state that you don't want. So those two phenomena, entanglement and superposition, are what give quantum computers their power. So what kind of quantum computers exist in the world today? So there are a whole bunch of different companies trying to make a quantum computer. Google, Intel, IBM, Microsoft, D-Wave, amongst others. And to complicate matters, there's not just one kind of quantum computer. There's actually a whole load of different approaches. I've broken them all down here. An important thing to point out here are universal quantum computers. Universal quantum computing can theoretically simulate any quantum system, and so it's the fundamental computing machinery of the universe. There's other approaches that aren't universal, like quantum annealing and ion trap systems. What they're focused on are solving certain niche problems better than classical computers by taking advantage of quantum physics. And they're a valid approach if those kinds of problems are valuable. They can be used as a good stepping stone towards a universal quantum computer, because universal quantum computers are very difficult to build and it's good to learn stuff along the way. I've also included the number of qubits in these quantum computers as of today. Now, qubit number is just one measure of how good a quantum computer is. Just as important is how low the noise is in the qubits, so how high quality the qubits are, and also how well the qubits are connected together. So let me describe a bit more about how you do the experiment to prove quantum supremacy. Actually, measuring when it's happened is quite a difficult thing to do. So you take your best quantum computer, you take your best supercomputer, and you need to give them a problem to solve and then compare the results. And to begin with, quantum computers can't do anything better than a supercomputer except for one thing, and that's be a quantum computer. Which might sound absurd, but the logic is this. You can simulate a quantum computer on a classical computer, but it gets more and more difficult to do so the more qubits you have. Now, IBM has got the current record for simulating a quantum computer with 56 qubits. So people are seeing this as the target, that if you build a quantum computer with more than 56 qubits, you can't simulate that with a classical computer, and so the quantum computer can do something better than what a classical computer can do. So the problem that they're looking at showing that the quantum computer can beat a classical computer at is a certain problem called a sampling problem. Now, if you remember back when I was talking about a qubit being in a superposition state between 0 and 1, that gives you the probability of which one you'll get back. Imagine if you've got 50 qubits and they're all entangled together. They are simultaneously in about a quadrillion states. That's a million billion states at the same time. But when you measure that computer, it just gives you back one state, which will just be a bit string of 00101111 corresponding to each qubit. Now, if you keep measuring it, that computer over and over and over again, you'll get different bit strings back, so different states back. But over time, you'll build up a distribution of those states, the more likely ones and the less likely ones. And that's a probability distribution. And each time you measure the quantum computer, that's like taking one sample from that probability distribution. Now, quantum computers do that completely naturally, whereas simulating that whole thing on a classical computer is incredibly difficult. So that's the problem that they're looking at, proving that a quantum computer can do it better than a classical computer. So what's that problem good for? Absolutely nothing, to begin with. I mean, there is some crossover between this kind of sampling problem and a sampling problem you get in machine learning, but the shapes of those problems in quantum computing and machine learning are very, very different. But they come from the same sort of underlying physics, which is called statistical mechanics. So there's a tentative overlap there, which people like Google are very, very interested in. But I don't want to undersell this achievement, because if you think about it, classical computers have been around for 70 years, and they've had literally trillions of dollars worth of money pumped into research and development to reach them to the incredibly sophisticated machines they are now. Quantum computers have been around for 20 years-ish and have had, say, $100 million, maybe $1 billion worth of investment. For that technology, this new novel technology, to come along and beat the classical computers in even one narrow thing is a huge achievement, and that's only going to progress in the future, and I'm really excited to see how that whole thing unfolds. And finally, I just want to end with a fact that I think is incredible. You know, I said that you can simulate, using our best supercomputers, you can simulate a quantum computer with 56 qubits. Now, if you raise the number of qubits up to 260, the size of computer you'd need to simulate that would need more bits than there are atoms in the entire known universe, which I think is just absolutely bonkers, but I love it. Thanks so much for watching. That's all I've got for you today. And thanks also to the sponsor of this video, brilliant.org. They're a website where you learn by doing. And I don't know about you, when I was at university, I would sit down, I'd write down all the lecture notes. But the time where I'd really learn the subject was when I sat down and did problems. And Brilliant do a great job of making this fun and slightly addictive. They have a way of framing questions that I get slightly obsessed with trying to work out the answer to. But that makes it really fun, and they cover a bunch of different subjects: physics, mathematics, computer science, and many more. So if you're interested in checking that out, go to brilliant.org/DOS. The link's also in the description below. And otherwise, thank you for watching again, and I'll see you on the next video.